So good at being in trouble, spending my days out in the ghetto. Mama say that I need to be careful, going downtown on the blue line metro. Car overheated and I can't afford a rental. Broke down Chevrolet sitting on Central. My headphones looking out the window. Lauryn Hill playing, it could be so simple. Damn, I just can't wait till I get home. What the hell is taking so long? I wish I had a girl by my side. Wish I had a brand new ride.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome, and thank you so much for joining us on this sunny Saturday morning for an important conversation about racial justice, community power building, and pedestrian safety at the intersection of youth-centered spaces. Maybe we can pause the music for a sec. Thank you. Awesome. Good morning, everybody. My name is Anisha Hingarani with People for Mobility Justice. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I will be one of your co-hosts today. So before we begin, one of the goals is to create an inclusive space to encourage participation. So this event includes simultaneous Spanish translation. I'd like to introduce our Spanish interpreter, Jose Eduardo, to share more about these features. Jose Eduardo, do you want to go ahead? Oh, okay. Harold, I think we need to take off the interpretation feature right now and put it back on after Jose Eduardo has had his chance to share.
Okay, I believe that Marianne will need to disable that temporarily, is how that will work.
All right, let me do that right now.
Buenos días a todos. Mi nombre es José Eduardo. Estoy aquí con mi colega Gloria y el día de hoy vamos a estar interpretando en inglés y en español.
Hello, everybody. My name is Gloria and I'm here with my colleague José Eduardo. And today we're going to be interpreting in English and in Spanish.
Para crear un espacio bilingüe el día de hoy, va a llevar la responsabilidad de todas las personas que están aquí, no solo de las intérpretes. Entonces, les vamos a enseñar algunas pautas que podemos usar para crear este espacio juntos.
So, in order to create a multilingual space here today, we all have a responsibility and we are going to be showing you some guidelines on how to do that.
En un momentito vamos a encender la interpretación de nuevo. Van a recibir una notificación abajo de su pantalla con un globo terráqueo que dice interpretación.
So in just a moment, you are going, we're going to turn on the interpretation and you are going to see a globe at the bottom of your screen and then you'll be able to choose the language that you prefer to participate in through that.
Okay, cuando hagan clic en ese botón, van a poder escoger el idioma en el que quieren participar. Si quieren escuchar y participar en español, escojan español. Si quieren escuchar y participar en inglés, escojan inglés.
So you will be able to click on that globe, choose the language English or Spanish. If you want to listen and participate in Spanish, choose the Spanish button. If you want to listen and participate in English, make sure to do that same thing for English.
Okay. Les vamos a pedir especialmente a los panelistas que por favor tengan cuidado en la velocidad y el sonido de su voz para asegurarnos que podamos interpretar.
So we are going to ask, especially for our panelists, to just be careful when speaking. Make sure you're speaking at a moderate pace and that you are speaking clearly so we can keep up.
También les pedimos que solamente una persona hable a la vez. Como intérpretes, no queremos tener que privilegiar una voz sobre la otra.
And we also want to ask that only one person speak at a time. As interpreters, we do not want to privilege one voice over the other.
Y por último, no sufran en silencio si es que no escuchan la interpretación, algo no está funcionando bien. Por favor, siéntanse libres de ponerlo en el chat para que alguien les pueda ayudar.
And lastly, please do not suffer in silence. If you cannot hear or you feel like you're not being heard, you may put it in the chat box so somebody can give you the support that you need.
De nuevo, les queremos agradecer a todas las personas organizando este evento por su compromiso a la justicia del lenguaje y por crear este espacio bilingüe el día de hoy.
And again, we just want to thank all the organizers of this event for creating a multilingual space and a language justice space today. Thank you.
Great. Thank you both so much. Next slide, please. So today's conversation is important for so many reasons, primarily because we're talking about the urgent need to protect and defend Black lives. Earlier this week, we found out about the heartbreaking news of Dijon Kizzy, a 29-year-old Black man who was murdered in South LA by the LA County Sheriff's Department, who stopped him because he was riding his bike and shot him over 20 times. We know too well that because of our society's white supremacist and anti-Black origins and systems, being Black in public can be a death sentence. And we all need to do our part to end the systems and structures that uphold this violence, especially those of us working on pedestrian safety and active transportation issues. So I'd like to take this next few moments of silence to lift up Dijon Kizzy, offer his family thoughts of peace and justice, and to say his name if you feel called to. Thank you, everybody. Next slide.
All right. Hi, everybody. I'm Adonia Lugo. I'm one of the folks who's here in the background helping to support today's webinar. Very excited to be here as a supporter. And we want to just talk through some working agreements and Zoom housekeeping, of course. You are all Zoom experts now after several months of spending way too many of your waking hours in this space. But as a reminder, we invite you to stay present in this special space that's being created by the group today. Please keep yourself on mute so that we don't have confusion for the interpretation or background noise. This webinar is being recorded so that it can be shared afterwards. So if you want to just keep that in mind and just share questions and whatnot with us more privately, that's okay. We invite you to use the chat function to send us any thoughts that you have. We welcome having some dialogue going on in that space. You can also use Q&A to say hello, like Eli did, or to send questions to the panelists. And you can also use the raise hand function to engage today. So that's just a little bit of Zoom housekeeping. And we wanted to start with acknowledging the Native people of the places that we're joining from today. And because I am here through my role at Antioch University, Los Angeles, we're hosting the Zoom space today. I wanted to share the land acknowledgement that we developed for our campus. So Antioch, for anyone who's not familiar with it, is over in Culver City, very close to Ladera Heights. And that means we're in Tongva territory, as many of us are from where we're joining from today. So Antioch University, Los Angeles, Yangar resides on Tovangar, the traditional and unceded territory of the Tongva people. These lands and the Tongva people continue to carry the stories of this nation and the people's struggles for survival and identity. With this land acknowledgement, we take a step toward learning these stories and identifying ways to join in decolonial and indigenous movements for sovereignty and self-determination. So if everybody wants to take a moment to take a look at this map, if it's a new resource you're not familiar with, it's really great. This is a map created by a Native artist, Timara Loda Link, and just identify for yourself where are some of the sites that are important to you in California, who are the indigenous stewards who've been in relationship with the land for thousands of years. And with that, I'm going to pass things over to Yolanda.
Hey, thank you so much, Adonia, and welcome everyone today. I am just in awe by the team that has brought us here to this moment, both schools and community-based organizations, as well as the actual team that helped me pull this together. So just to share a little bit about me, basically, I am a native of Los Angeles, actually born and raised in one of the communities that we're representing today, which is West Adams. Basically, I also am a recent graduate, 2018, went back in this phase of my life and actually got a master's in urban sustainability, which really focuses on social and environmental justice. I'm able to use that knowledge along with the grassroots work that I've been doing for the past 9 years in terms of mobility justice, pedestrian safety for children, as well as for adults and seniors, and basically to be able to come back and spread the word. So that's really what this is about today. Basically, I think, I started in 2011, as I mentioned, igniting an effort called Ride and Living Color. And Ride and Living Color was an effort to gather the narratives of African Americans on bikes in particular. But through that process of gathering the narratives and an effort actually to create a documentary, I actually I came to a crossroads, and instead of becoming a full-fledged documentarian, I became an advocate for creating safer streets, also looking at the disenfranchised communities that I actually grew up in. Growing up in this area in the 60s, it actually, before that and even during that, is labeled as a red line community. And so those were things that we just took for granted, really not knowing, you know, why don't we have crosswalks that are basically plentiful in our community so that we don't have to run across the street versus just walking across the street. And so that's what this is all about today. Is to pretty much take this information and spread it to our, you know, block to block in terms of building awareness for our parents, making connections with our schools, and making connections in terms of mutual aid, as well as community support and village with our community-based organizations. So thank you again for joining us.
Thank you, Yolanda. So this event was created out of Yolanda's vision and came to life through a labor of love. And so many people featured and not featured today are responsible for this undertaking, including people from Mobility Justice, Antioch University and their Los Angeles campuses Masters of Urban Sustainability Program, the SoCal Association of Governments Go Human Campaign, and Tecolot Incorporated. Next slide. Today, we will hear from a slate of amazing speakers, including our school representatives, Brooke Rios and Dee Russell from New LA Charter School, and Kimberly Wright of Cienega Elementary School, who will share their experiences on responding to the pedestrian safety needs of students and their families. We also have South LA-based community leaders and activists, Aura Vasquez, Channing Martinez, Marta Segura, and Michaela Randolph, who come with backgrounds in environmental justice, urban and transportation planning, and built environment advocacy, centering Black Indigenous communities of color. Before we get started with the first panel, I just wanted to note that as part of this, we collected over 45 surveys from parents of school communities in West Adams and Mid-City, and that really helped shape the vision for the event. We're offering raffles to those who filled out the survey, and that'll be announced via email next week, and the prizes as well. Next slide, please. Here's the overview of how the event is going to flow. So we'll hear from school representatives for the first panel, and then community leaders for the second panel, and then bring them all together for the third panel, where we'll have a free-flowing conversation, and speakers will have an opportunity to ask each other questions based on what they've heard. So now let me hand it over to Yolanda.
Okay, thank you, Anisha. Next slide. Okay, do we have a slide that we were actually going to put up here just to give a little intro into both New LA
I'll
and
I'll get
Cienega.
The next slide up. Yep.
Okay. So to get started, as I mentioned before, just to the grounding of this conversation that we're about to have with New LA and Cienega is that this community convening aims to meaningfully create a platform to acknowledge the narratives of the school communities, and that is the school administrators and parent advocates today. They are the ones who have the direct experience in terms of what our needs are and being able to also be present to discuss how we can more effectively and meaningfully and compassionately move forward. Today, again, we have New LA Charter School and Cienega Middle School. New LA actually is a middle school that is located in Mid-City, and my daughter actually attended this school between 2013 and 2016. And New LA was the only middle school actually that was located in this community, basically of Mid-City West Adams. So if it wasn't for this school, my daughter and I would not actually be the advocates we are today, because basically most of the schools we drove to a further location to go to school. So we were able to walk, bike, take public transportation and drive in terms of experiencing the mobility challenges that exist even within our block to block community. And one of the things that actually my daughter and I did in this experience of walking and biking to school was to reimagine. Because I grew up in this community and actually went to a Catholic school that's no longer here, but it's on La Brea and Adams, St. Agatha, the church is still there. Basically, it wasn't until my daughter was born that I actually kind of walked the streets and biked the streets in this community as far as going to a school. So we would walk and reimagine how our streets can look better, how awesome it would be to have bike lanes, you know, what it's going to take to get the trash out of the streets, clean sidewalks, clean bus stations. And so basically it was through the experience of going to New LA that really ignited me to actually where I am today in terms of having this webinar. So just to show that connection pretty much with New LA. It's also only a quarter a mile away from the 10 freeway on the Washington corridor, Washington Boulevard and Burnside. So that you can imagine the cars are basically just constantly flying by, and the kids have to cross the street from the bus stop over to the school. And so that's how the advocacy work started at New LA. Cienega is a school that is located on the Adams corridor. And according to Vision Zero, Adams Boulevard is a high injury network corridor. And so let alone the Adams corridor, we have the residential streets that there is a high traffic capacity that's running, rolling through the communities as well. So Cienega is surrounded by the Adams corridor, the Jefferson corridor, and La Brea. So basically in terms of the traffic congestion around this school, it is unbelievable. And also the fact that I think we're dealing with unpredictable cars coming out of nowhere, traffic congestion, and a problem both for pedestrians as well as parents that are dropping off their children along with school staff. Whereas New LA is speeding, extreme speeding, because we're located near the 10 freeway. So just to kind of set the scenario up of basically how I came to be connected in this community to these two schools. And I actually went to Cienega for summer school in the 70s. So that's old school in terms of just my connection in these cases to these schools. We are going to just without further ado, just move into now the first question basically for our school administrators and parent advocate. And that question, since we have introduced, welcome Brooke, Deneen, Russell, and Kimberly. And thank you so much for just being a part of the webinar today and just the amazing work that you're doing. So the first question that I have for you guys is, in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic, paired with the already existing concerns that you were working on as it related to pedestrian safety for your students, along with other mobility justice issues, environmental issues around your school, where does this reality today position you as a principal, an executive director, and parent advocate? And how are you holding and handling these needs at this time? And we will start with Kimberly at Cienega.
Good morning, everyone. First of all, thank you for to Yolanda and also to the team at Antioch and whomever else I'm leaving out to host today's webinar. It's an honor to be here in a very relevant situation that we're dealing with. Also, it was a very interesting way of how we opened with our Native Americans in terms of the land development. Something at Cienega and all of LAUSD, we have what's called an academic English mastery program, and we deal with students of color. And that I'm going to kind of steal that map because we want to also make it relevant to our students. But that's a very loaded question that you asked, Yolanda, in terms of what we're dealing with in terms of COVID-19, as well as what our needs are. Because in COVID-19, we're trying to win. We're not just trying to do enough to lose this situation, but we're trying to win in this situation. And we have a model that's called hashtag going the distance. So you probably see me turning because my teachers are here trying to just get materials for next week. And that's something that they do. If you think about it, they're Zooming all week. So they have to be on from 9 to 2:15 Monday through Friday, except for yesterday and this upcoming Monday during the holiday. So we're working 6 days a week, just trying to provide our boys and girls with what they need in order to be successful. So we are in a new norm right now, a new way of doing things, such as this webinar by Zoom. This is our new normal. This is our way of communicating, whether it is with, and I hope I'm answering this. Is this what you're looking for, Yolanda? in terms of COVID?
Yes, yes. I mean, we cannot not talk about COVID. So, okay. You know, in terms of pretty much how you're dealing with it from a standpoint of COVID, but we also talked about the fact that, you know, before COVID hit, you had students actually on campus, yes. And now you don't. And so yeah. Basically, I would like for you to kind of say, how are you thinking about this? Because one day, you know, we will get back to the schools. And that is a reality just in terms of the space that you're in. Yes. So, you know, we're at the intersection. And so we have to still continue to push for this pedestrian safety. So I would like for you to also just tap into that as well.
Pedestrian safety is huge, a huge concern. I brought this concern up to, let me just tell you why. It's because at the corner of Sycamore and Adams, we have an actual crosswalk. And so that's Sycamore Adams. And then you have Sycamore. And so that's going northwest and then east and then east west. I'm sorry, that's going north south and then east west. We have right. Another crosswalk. Now we have crosswalks also just going east and west on Orange Drive, of which our cars come. So our cars actually come onto Orange Drive, but yet we do not have any traffic signals. So we've had several accidents, car accidents, and we also had parents and students physically hit where, you know, the accident was on person. So it is a huge concern. Now, I've been principal here at Cienega for 10 years and then was the assistant principal for a year and a few months. So I would say for the last at least 12 years, we've been asking the city and the Department of Transportation for us to just get a crossing guard to help wow. us out. And we still haven't gotten that. That's with several emails. That's with several even asking for help from LA Unified. But again, we haven't gotten that support. We do have a program that's called Safety Valet, where it's just like a valet and the parents drive the students up. Our staff opens the door and then we escort the children inside of the school so that there will be a safe way for them to get in. Now, because at one point we had over 800 students, now we have close to 600 students. So you can imagine how the cars are on Orange Drive, but they're backed up onto Adams. So that creates such a traffic jam for those that are our car riders. So we are in dire need of having a crossing guard and even, you know, a signal light. But I know that'd be kind of hard because it's in between literally one block. And okay. our school is so deceiving because if you just look at it from the standpoint of Adams, you think, oh, that's a nice little school, mm-hmm. until you don't realize we take up a half a city block. Yes. And it is a very large campus. So pedestrian safety is a huge concern and has been a huge concern. I don't understand why it's been so difficult for us to have such a hard time just getting a crossing guard because it's ridiculous to be over a decade just trying to get that type of support. So what happens is that now that we have COVID and of course we have to come back in person, that will more than likely look like a hybrid model, meaning that only half of the students will come maybe 2 days a week, and then the other half will come maybe 2 days a week. So it's going to be, in the beginning, probably a lot of, I'm not going to say a lot of confusion, it's going to be organized chaos until we actually right. figure out or become, get into a routine of how that new normal is going to look like once we're back on campus.
Right, right. And could you just tell me this before we move on to New LA? And of course, this conversation is going to continue. But do you know how many of your students were actually walking? Kind of an idea of who was walking to school versus who was catching buses within the community. and or being dropped off by their parents?
So we don't have many bus riders at Cienega. Only, I would say, our special needs students
for
their IEP. So we only have maybe about 20 kids, if that.
Out of the 500 plus kids.
Yes, that are, yes, because although they're special needs, they may live within the walking, you know, zone of our school, so they're not afforded the bus, a bus per their IEP or transportation home to school. But I would say 40% of our students walk to school.
Wow.
And then about 60% are car riders.
60. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the interesting.
And there's more than 500 students here. So
yeah,
we're looking at close to six.
Close to six. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's a point I wanted to make, you know, be actually at the intro that we're talking about, no matter where these kids go to school, they're at school-centered spaces. And these are our children, you know, our babies. And so basically we're talking about almost 900 kids. That's what this conversation is about. Mm-hmm. Almost 900 lives. And so I think that is something that, you know, really should resonate with us when we're, and then you guys, you and Brooke and all the parent advocates are the ones that are really, you know, have to oversee that they're able to make it to school, make it to school, make sure it's safe for them to get home so they can come back to school the next day, you know, for the entire year.
And Yolanda, I do want to add that we also have staff. And
correct.
So the staff, we're also trying to come into the school at the same time sometimes that our students are, because staff don't come at the same time. You know, you have early morning people that may be your custodial staff. You have your cafeteria staff that's making breakfast and lunch. Then you start to have your administrators. Then you start to have your teachers. And then you start to have your teacher assistants, and then, you know, your paraprofessionals, you have your yard supervision people. So people just look at students, but then you have another 100 people that are still coming into the school in order to make sure our boys and girls are safe. So before we even get into the gate, we also have to look at the safety of our staff as well.
Correct. Yes. And that definitely is something I know I emphasized, you know, at the beginning. You know, it is your entire school-centered space and all the human lives, you know, that are connected with it. And how do we keep that going? So thank you so much for sharing that insight with me, Kimberly. And we do have a second question. And again, we will be moving into a third segment to keep this going. So now we're going to pull in New LA. Brooke, and is Deneen with us today as well?
Hi, good morning, Yolanda. I don't see Deneen on, so I just want to pause. And Deneen, if you are here, I don't see you.
In the attendees list. So maybe we can promote Deneen to a panelist.
Yeah, that would be great.
We could get her on board. Welcome, Brooke. Good to see you this morning. And yes, as I have given the description of kind of what we worked on together beginning in 2013, actually until this current day, to talk about the pedestrian issues that existed at that time. And then as I asked Kimberly, you know, in the midst of COVID-19 pandemic, the already existing issues around pedestrian safety in the community of color that New LA is, how are you holding that now? Mm-hmm. And how are you working with all these needs at this time?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Yolanda. I just first want to say thank you so much for your advocacy on behalf of our school as a parent. You are a great role model for me as a community leader, and thank you for inviting me to participate in the conversation. And Kimberly, it's really nice to meet you. And just listening to the story at Cienega, I'm sure it hits you in a similar way, Yolanda. I just hear so many common threads as to what happened down the street at New LA, because this seriously is a community issue. I want to start just by talking a little bit about who New LA serves, so who comes to our school. New LA Middle School is located in Mid-City. And currently about 90% of our students at the middle school are Latinx, 8% are African American. We have about 2% who are white. And I think 84% of our students qualify for free and reduced lunch. So when we're talking about the impact of COVID, what I've seen happen is COVID-19 has just widened the ever-existing opportunity gap for our students. And so they are greatly impacted. Our families, our students, they're depending on us for meals, you know, for needs that already existed and have just been exasperated by the situation. And when our school opened in the community, we opened in Mid-City because the former middle school, the public middle school that was serving Mid-City, Louis Pasteur, was turned into a high-performing magnet, and it's very difficult to get into LACES. In fact, we encourage families to apply every year because, you know, it'd be great. We promote our local community school, but, you know, also to get magnet points because they almost never get in, and so they can use those magnet points for high school. So when we came into the community, when we were developing the property, we reached out to LADOT and to other entities to find out if we could get a traffic light or some way to cross students on Washington Boulevard. And what we were told was that a traffic study was conducted at the intersection of Washington and Burnside, and that intersection didn't qualify for a crosswalk. And we were directed to ask families to walk down the street and cross the street at Washington and Hauser, where there is a crosswalk right down the street. And so we tried to do that. And essentially what happened was we have students who are trying to cross Washington Boulevard, families who are trying to cross Washington Boulevard, and the corridor where the school is located has like a blind turn, and people are flying down Washington at 8 o'clock in the morning. And so we literally had students and families who are trying to like dodge cars getting across the street. And it became very evident if someone were to get hit on Washington in that way, we were definitely looking at a fatality. So we continued to reach out. We continued to ask LADOT, again, other public officials to help with this. We kept getting met with the same message: that intersection does not qualify, go down the street, cross at Hauser. In the meantime, within the first few years of students attending our school, we had several students who were hit by cars on the way to school. And thankfully, those students were not hit on Washington because, again, I believe that that would result in a fatality with the rate of speed. And so finally, we, in partnership with Mid-City Neighborhood Council, with strong parent advocacy and parents like Deneen, parents like Yolanda. Yolanda was really the first parent to come in and kind of take up a structured organizing of this issue. Those factors, along with really naming the issue. So writing to public officials and saying, we have a social justice issue here. We have students, we have Black and Brown students who are trying to get to school, who are risking their lives to walk to school every day, really calling out the racial factor in this. And also notifying people and putting people on blast every time we had an incident. And thank God, and the incidents were students not only from New LA, but from other schools in the community were hit by cars. There were never serious injuries, but again, it's only a matter of time before there is one. And that's not something anyone wants to play around with here. So again, Yolanda was a parent at New LA, and we ended up working together with Mid-City Neighborhood Council, uplifting the voices of parents and students. And I think that was key in getting this traffic signal and crosswalk approved in 2015. For the next 5 years, as we checked in on the progress of this project, we were faced with, there's no funding. It's been approved, it hasn't been funded. Until finally last year, days before the start of school, a motorcyclist was flying down Washington Boulevard. A car was turning right out of Burnside, no traffic signal there to moderate traffic. Collision happened. We were told that that accident either resulted in a fatality or paralysis for the man on the motorcycle. And so it really, our efforts never stopped, but it kind of stoked the fire back up. And so we did some real advocacy this year. Yolanda was involved with that. And right before COVID-19, we were told that the signal was funded. So interestingly for us, during this COVID time, they have been working on installing the traffic signal. So there's a lot of work happening on the streets. It took 10 years to make that happen. A lot of advocacy, you know, again, from parents, students, school administrators, neighborhood council, folks at CD10, really coming together to kind of get through some barriers that were invisible, right? I feel pretty confident that, you know, I don't think it would have taken 10 years, you know, in the case at Cienega, you're looking at more than 10 years to get infrastructure installed in a community to protect the lives of children. Correct. And so I think naming that is really important.
Yes, yes. I mean, that's a mouthful, and it's so true in terms of understanding that timeline and the work that has been put into it. I'm going to see what our time is remaining because I know we have to stay on schedule, and but I do have a second question. So before I say that second question, I'm going to just get a feedback on that. But I would say that, yeah, actually, that's also just what ignites me, because also growing up in this community and seeing that it hasn't changed for decades, that the Adams Corridor, along with the Washington Corridor, that I'm very familiar with. And that's a shame. You know, I mean, you know, that's just a very basic statement. That's a shame that this, the funding has not been put into it. The education hasn't been put into it. And that's something that we want to continue in this conversation today. So with roughly, let's have Dee speak, and then maybe we'll have to take my second question into the third segment. So Dee, are you on with us? We're waiting. I think they have transferred her. She says, oh, she can't talk right now because she's actually at work. So she's listening in, but she is one of our representatives, and maybe she can share some chats with us, Dee, and then that will be translated or sent to us so that we can, throughout the webinar, be able to give your insight on some things. But we worked, she's, of course, great. So we worked hand in hand with Brooke, and she was very much involved in everything that Brooke's talking about, and I'm talking about. Her child, her children actually were there at the same time mine, my daughter was, and then after. My daughter graduated in 2016. So Dee's actually was there for like another year or two, Brooke. Is that the case? Okay. Yeah. So basically, let's go to our second question real quickly. And then if you guys can just maybe be a little brief with this, but understanding will continue in the third segment. But can you share at least a minute or so of what a lessons in this efforts that you have spoke about, lessons learned that are key lessons that you believe we can move, you know, pass that on to other schools, other parent advocates, school administrators, in terms of what you have learned over this 12 and 10 years as it deals with pedestrian safety. And if you want to insert, you know, kind of in pairing that with COVID in this time, in terms of some ideas of how we can move forward and continue this conversation. So Kimberly, we'll start with you, a success story or a key lesson that you have learned that you think is beneficial to carry on.
The biggest lesson is always have some sort of system in place as it relates to any type of safety. So what do I mean by that? There needs to be, as I said, we have a safety valet program. So the parents know that for those that are riding in cars, they have to only come one way. There's only one way into the school and one way out of the school. So there has to be a system in place in order to make sure that everyone's safe. And because you have so many people coming onto campus, you need to have a way that you can track everyone. There needs to be because we don't have a crossing guard, you know, yes. that they have to use the crosswalks. They just can't walk in the middle of the street, whether that's on Adams, Sycamore, or on Orange Drive, even though you live directly in front of that gate, you know, in the apartment building across the street. You have to develop systems and routines in order to keep everyone safe. And we need to make sure that we're practicing those, we're reminding people of those particular routines. Another thing that I learned was when it starts to get chaotic, we need to bring in, you know, unfortunately we have to give out tickets because there has to be some sort of consequence for that. And I know in the day of Black Lives Matter and things that, and I'm not going to say the day of, we've always had Black Lives Matter, but it's just heightened that everybody knows about Black Lives Matter now. And so police may not always be seen in the friendly light. However, we still need some sort of law and order in order to make sure that we're practicing best practices in terms of safety. So I think that's the greatest success story that we have is our safety valet, and also creating partnerships within the city and the community in order for us to make sure that our boys and girls and families are safe.
Okay. Yeah, those are strong.
I'm sorry?
Those are strong, you know, directions that I know will definitely can continue in terms of what does that look like? How do we go into our new normal on success stories that have worked? And maybe, you know, how do they need to be transitioned, if you will, you know, in some places that we can still have the process of respect, number one, education and law and order. What does law and order look like? Does that mean the community plays a part in that law and order versus police? That's something that we'll be talking about. I know one of our community-based organizations, Channing, will probably have a lot to share with us on that. And so let's go to, because I know we're almost out of time, I would like to get, Brooke, would you like to share, or can you please share, actually, one of your success stories or lessons learned?
Yeah, I think the success was actually getting this traffic signal, which isn't plugged in yet, but it's there. And making that progress on it after 10 years. And I think the things that kind of push this forward for us, you know, I want to second what Kimberly talked about with just, you know, when you don't have the infrastructure in place or the systems in place outside of the school, you need to make sure that you're doing everything you can organizationally to keep, you know, kids safe and families safe on their way to school. And, you know, it can be really difficult. You cannot have a crossing guard if you don't have a crosswalk. You can't illegally put school personnel in the middle of Washington or Adams Boulevard to cross kids. So you really have to figure out a way to manage that. I think for us, in terms of the advocacy work, our partnership with Mid-City Neighborhood Council was invaluable. Not sure this could have happened without that. Parent advocacy, it wouldn't have happened without that. Without a parent like Deneen or with Yolanda, who could really be the voice of the community, I think those partnerships are critical. I think for us, one of the things that we did is part of our social justice curriculum, we did a study with students. We did a seminar on traffic safety patterns in Los Angeles, and they got to look at data from LADOT and look at which neighborhoods were experiencing traffic fatalities and which neighborhoods had those types of issues with lack of infrastructure, and who are the people who live in those neighborhoods, and what did it look like in their neighborhood? And that really empowered student voice. So we actually had a peaceful student protest that happened. Students wrote letters to city officials, and they were able to use some of what they learned based on the data that's available. So I think that educational component was really important. And again, uplifting parent and student voices in that conversation, because at the end of the day, those were the people who were heard. And then I think, you know, in terms of school administration, you know, offering the space for those voices to be uplifted and heard, making those partnerships with government officials, with neighborhood councils, but also documenting and naming what is going on. We cannot afford to be race neutral in this country. And so naming, we have a social justice issue here. This is who is walking to this school every morning, who literally is risking their life to get to school, to get an education. We're talking about access to education for students of color here. And they're facing literally roadblocks on the way to school. That's a problem. Yeah. And so naming that piece of it, I think, has been critical.
Yeah, that's powerful. I mean, I think that last statement, both what you and Kimberly have shared, and just the right to have access to education and to move around in our spaces is literally what we're talking about, that we actually don't, you know, I think a lot of people of color really don't think about it because we've had to go through it for so long, you know, but we shouldn't have to wonder if we're going to make it. So we're about to wrap up here in terms of moving into our session two, our segment two. But just thank you both for, and Deneen, for your feedback via chat in terms of sharing insight in our school narratives. And thank you again. And now we will move into segment two, which Anisha will be handling with our amazing community advocates, activists, and leaders. Anisha?
Thank you, Yolanda. Thank you so much, Kimberly. Thank you so much, Brooke. And thank you, Dee. I know you couldn't be with us, but I know you're there, and I appreciate all of your advocacy. So we're going to move now into our second panel featuring community leaders and organizers who have been fighting for racial and environmental justice for decades. Next slide, please. So we're so honored to create a space with these amazing individuals. We have Aura, an environmental justice activist, igniter of Ready to Help, a mutual aid community network, a past commissioner for LADWP, and a past candidate for City Council's District 10. And we also have Channing Martinez, the Director of Organizing at the Labor Community Strategy Center in Los Angeles, and also a past candidate for City Council's District 10. We have Marta Segura, a health equity strategist and principal of Vida Verde, served as district director for then council member Eric Garcetti, a past Metro Community Advisory Council member, and a past City of LA Planning Commissioner. And last but not least, we have Michaela Randolph, a community activist and founder of Randolph Consulting Group, and previously held positions, leadership positions, with the National Safe Routes to School Partnership and Children and Nature Network. Thank you all so much for joining us. We can stop share so we can see all of our faces. Thank you. So we heard earlier an important conversation on traffic violence, and I also heard kind of the impact of racialized public disinvestment in community infrastructure, like schools, like streets, streetscapes, food even, and food access, as well as transportation. These are such important contexts to hold amidst the multiple roles that schools strive to provide for Black and Brown youth, including delivering high quality education, creating safe and empowering spaces for young people, and being responsible and engaged stewards in the surrounding communities of West Adams and Mid-City. So my first question to my community leaders, panelists, is your reactions based on what you heard and your experience. How can community activists better center these schools as sites of community power building? How do we center and uplift the, you know, almost 900 young people of color, school staff, in these schools in their fight for mobility justice?
If I can start off and others can join. Hi everyone, Michaela Randolph. And just really grateful to be a part of this conversation today. I really appreciate the perspectives that were shared, you know, from the school community and all the organizers, you know, who have curated this discussion today. One of the things that, you know, I've worked on is Safe Routes to School at a national level, and the focus of my work has always been on Black and Brown communities and low-income communities, because there's an invisibility in transportation, specifically when people are walking, biking, taking the bus. Like, when we're thinking about who's being counted and whose experiences matter, there often is an invisibility with our lower income communities of color, specifically, you know, our Latinx population, our Black community. And when we share the stories of what has happening in and around our school community or in our home communities, it's often dismissed by key decision makers. And I think now is the time where communities should feel so emboldened and so empowered that it is a groundswell approach. Like, we, the community, matter. We are utilizing our voices to say, this is our lived experience. It's valid. It is true. And that we need change, right? So I think, you know, the principal from New LA Charter, Brooke, said it so well, that we just can't afford to be in this space of being race neutral, right? We have to really uplift and continue to tell the stories of, you know, the what it means to be walking and biking while Black, Brown, you know, what it means to be a lower income member of the community that is not seen, you know, in the wee hours trying to get from one side of the town, one side of town to the other side of town, you know. So we have to continue to validate and lift up in a groundswell way, you know, these narratives of our community. So that's my initial reaction. I'm happy to pass it to my other panel.
Hi, everyone. This is Martha Segura, and I really appreciate being part of this mobility justice panel and all the work that's gone into it. So thank you for inviting me. I'm going to come at it from an angle of a public health and environmental justice perspective. Start there, because I think what we seek in that field, in those movements, is the root causes of any outbreak, any illness, death rates, cancer rates. And in this particular case, we're looking at accidents in school zones. So you have to pull back the lens sometimes and not just look at the built environment, but look at the different jurisdictions, agencies that were involved in creating and permitting legislation that allowed schools to be built without having cross guards, without having school zone improvements. So in other words, a school should never have been permitted to be in an area without school zone improvements and school safety features. That the cart came before the horse there, right? And you shouldn't be placing a school in an environment where those signals aren't, where the cross streets aren't, where the cross guards aren't. But now that we're here and the schools are present in areas that don't have these school zone improvements, I think it is key to understand and have a power analysis of who the decision makers are, from the state level to LAUSD, to the city, to the school itself, which is a form of government, and analyze all of the various jurisdictions, whether it be Metro and DOT, and how they should be working together to proactively create solutions to minimize the need for engagement of parents. And I obviously am 100% behind, and I am an organizer, parental engagement, community engagement, for pushing for these changes. But from a public health perspective, the burden shouldn't have to be on the community. We elect these legislators, we pay these agencies to proactively create a safe situation for our schools. So sometimes I think community organizers know what they need. The community understands what changes need to be made, but they don't often understand the jurisdictional divisions and how they silo those decisions, which complicates change at the local level. So I think it's going to be really important for us to understand, moving forward, why those school zones weren't there before the school was there, or why they weren't being built while the school was being permitted or zoned. So I think that that's really, really key. And I also wanted to say that coming down back to the school level, my husband is a cross guard. So I asked him, what do you see every day, right? And he says, I see parents speeding through the school zone. I see parents getting out of the car and arguing with each other when there's a long line for drop-offs. I see gang members coming into the area and not just harassing families, but also harassing the street vendors that are selling fruit or food for the parents to buy their kids while on their way to school. And what I don't see at this school, and I won't name the school, is I've asked time and again for the principal to get engaged, for them to come out into the patio, the area where the drop-off is being happened, you know, is taking place, and for them to be much more involved and to do more community awareness and community building. So this is in Inglewood, right? So it's in a Black and Brown community. And unfortunately, there is many times, as was being pointed out earlier, a disconnect between the responsibility of the school, the responsibility of the city, the responsibility of LAUSD, and everybody wants to say, you're responsible, not me. So all of the organizing strategies that Michaela, Brooke, and others have been mentioning, I think are going to be key from this point forward. But we also should say, hey, if we're demanding a school be built on this block, let's first think about what the traffic situation is, right? The safe walk, what does it look like for those crossing this particular street? And we almost want to push for those traffic improvements before we push for the school so that we don't have to do it after the fact. I'll stop right there.
If I can go next. Hello, everyone. Let me know if you can hear me good. I'm Aura Vasquez. Thank you so much for inviting me. I want to offer a perspective as someone that bikes herself, that has gotten hit by a car in the streets of Los Angeles, and also someone that was raised biking. You know, I'm originally from Colombia, and in the town where I'm from, we bike everywhere because we still can. And it's easier than taking the bus or taking a taxi. So that's been much in the culture, at least in my culture. And I know for a lot of immigrants that came to this country until not long ago, they were not allowed to have driver's licenses. So they relied on biking, taking public transit, walking to get to work and to do things that they needed to do every day. But I want to mention something that sometimes we overlook, which is the way that we design our city and urban planning. And complementing what Martha shared about why are the schools being, built without a real plan, especially at transportation, how much traffic is gonna bring. You know, we're in a moment in history where we see our city with one of the largest population of unhoused folks in the country, and where the city is, all of us are asking for more homes for them and for more homes that are affordable for all of us. So because we're growing in population and because we need to provide more housing to residents, it's important that we also think about how we can push for policies that make biking and walking easier. So what I would like to see in our city is that every time somebody wants to build a new, they want to start a new development, a building or so, that they're also required to include bike lanes in their planning, that they're also encouraged to have bike racks, maybe downstairs by the parking lot. When I was a representative for the Koreatown Neighborhood Council, we asked a lot of our development to do that, to put bike lanes, to put electrical vehicle infrastructure, which is not quite the conversation here, but I think it comes really much together. And from an environmental
from an environmental justice perspective, this is quite important because the more we advocate for policies that are going to make our urban planning more sustainable and also more focused on people, it's not just about cutting greenhouse gas emissions, but it's also how do we make it so that we can connect more? The other pandemic that we're suffering is the lack of unity and connection. People are really yearning, especially now that we've been sheltered in place, to have connection with other folks. So how do we think about our development, and as we build schools, as we build housings, as we build more hospitals, that we can connect to those maybe by biking and walking and other things? I mean, there are other people that use skates and, you know, other stuff that are also important. And, you know, I have been very close to the issue. Actually, the new school is very close to my home. And I see these intersections. And again, we are, especially in Los Angeles, we are a car-centric city. And also, we are in a patriarchal society that prizes, you know, capitalism. So our city certainly became a car city. It wasn't always this way. So how do we can take it back and make it more about people and less about, you know, cars, and make it more about being safe and being connected, because that's much of what we need right now. So I'm going to stop there, but I want to see definitely more policies, more advocacy around housing, and asking them also to put the bike lanes there and an all new development, just like we have had now require buildings to be solar ready. They should be bike lane ready, and they should be pedestrian, and the sidewalks should be more in place so that people can, you know, use it. So thank you, guys.
Hey, everyone. Channing Martinez. Thanks, Yolanda, for putting this together. And I really do want to thank Kimberly and Dr. Brooke for being so vulnerable with us and really, you know, starting with what's there. And I think that's what you got to start with. These are the conditions. These are what our students are going through. These are our students. And so thank you for that. So I'm the director of organizing for the Bus Riders Union, and it's a 30-year-old organization, which is a project of the Strategy Center. And we work with students at three high schools, at Augustus Hawkins High School, Roosevelt High School, and Ochi O'Donovan High School, which is an Alliance high school. And like Dr. Brooke described about working with students, we actually work with students to teach them the skills of organizing and advocacy. And so many of them have worked on previous campaigns and have won. And so we actually got LAUSD to return one tank, three grenade launchers, and 61 M16 assault rifles that they had, that they planned to use on their students. And in fact, when we talked about this, the grenade launchers, their excuse was to say that we don't plan to use grenades in them. We just plan to use pepper spray during fights in them, in our students, right? We just won this great victory where we cut the LAUSD LAUSD school police budget by $25 million, which has been a really great victory for our students and parents and communities. And so we win things, and we teach students how to become really successful organizers. And many of the organizers you see leading the work around the nation were once in the Strategy Center. So like Patrice Colors was a organizer with the Strategy Center and graduated from our National School for Strategic Organizing. But the main thing I want to say is, my reaction is, that's why we need no cars in LA. And that's why our campaign for urban transformation is so much more important. We have seven demands, free public transportation, no police on MTA buses and trains, no police in LAUSD schools, stop MTA attacks on the Black community, no cars in LA, 50% of all new jobs in the city of Los Angeles goes to Black people, and then cut the LAPD budget by 50%. And I think those are all very important, because what you're describing in terms of the conditions at your community has to be seen as very intentional, as Dr. Brooke was trying to say. So even when you take the way that we started this meeting by acknowledging the land and acknowledging the indigenous people. And so it isn't a simple situation as, can we get our traffic light? It has to be talked about to know that, you know, there's no traffic light there on purpose, because this country wants to kill and murder Black and Latinx people, because it's rooted in a racist society, and rooted in a racist history, right? And so that's where we start. And we have to assume that, yeah, there's agencies that are supposed to be responsible for that, but given that we live in a racist society, it is our job to fight back against them, right? It is the job of working class communities to fight back, right? And it has always been the job. In the 1960s, you can look at those movements, and it was only because of those movements in the 1960s that we got a lot of our basic rights today. And that is very much the history we've come out of. And so I guess my offer would be to figure out how to work with Brooke and Kimberly to really organize their students around all of these issues that they're experiencing, policing, experiencing in their schools, but also, you know, to even Kimberly's point, like, I hear you, we have a campaign to cut the police, but I hear you. Sometimes, you know, you're calling the police because that's the only person there, right? But how do we then move that to organize students to say that not that we should be ticketing individual people, but the city itself is built around the car. It's built around getting people there fast. And so I don't believe in ticketing the people for using the system that was built for them. We really have to change an entire system. And so how do we then organize around, you know, even our city council races and all the electoral races to demand that they actually take up real things, right? And so me and Alda, as an example, ran for LA City Council. In my opinion, we're the only two that come from a movement background that was actually speaking to the actual people in the streets. And many people, when I was standing in front of Albertsons, were saying, thank you. There's never been a candidate out here at Albertsons actually listening to me and speaking to me about the real issues that are going on in my community. Even if they didn't agree about cutting the LAPD budget, I mean, they felt heard, and they were saying mainly, we get you, I'm not gonna vote for you this time because you're young, but next time I will be voting for you, right? And so I think we need more work like that. I think we need more candidates like myself and Alda who are actually taking on the real issues and not simply, you know, just fighting for a thing here, but thinking about our struggles here in the United States as in the context of a world struggle, which is against a racist regime, a racist country. And so that's my offering.
Thank you so much to all of our panelists. That was so powerful, the way you all so easily went to the heart of the issue, the root causes of what we heard this morning, and the real vision of this conversation was, which is to talk about power, just talk about racism, patriarchy, systemic oppression. So thank you all so much for that and bringing your insights. We have a couple minutes left, and I don't often get to moderate a panel full of amazing activists. So when I do, I wanna be able to walk away feeling inspired, because I'm always inspired by organizers. So. You know, there's a lot of systems, structures, and policies identified that we need to reshape, shrink, or dismantle entirely. We've been talking about that. It's easy to focus on what needs to go, and then we don't really get the space to talk about what we want to create. And so I want to take this moment to bring in the words of Adrienne Marie Brown, a queer Black feminist and movement leader who said that all organizing is science fiction. We are bending the future together into something we have never experienced. A world where everyone experiences abundance, access, pleasure, human rights, dignity, freedom, transformative justice, and peace. So to my panelists, if you could keep it brief, what mobility justice alternatives and futures do you want to create? And I'll let whoever wants to get started to go ahead.
I think the vision of having no cars or less, you know, being mobility oriented versus car oriented is a phenomenal goal to aspire to. But in this transitional period, I think we need to understand that we need a real concrete power analysis so that these communities can get the investments that they need to make it so, to make it pedestrian oriented, to make it bicycle oriented, to make it, you know, skater oriented. And, you know, I'm talking about just beyond the schools, right? Because the school zones themselves need to be reformed, but the whole community needs to be reformed. In order for community to have the leverage and the power to do that, we need a really concrete power analysis. So I guess that's my call to action for all of the organizers to understand how the current system works so that we can transform it and create a new vision for that system to work for us.
I would chime in and say that I really envision a city where we're not prioritizing one form of modality over another, and where you, whether you're walking or biking or taking public transportation, that you feel equally valued, you know, by society, and that that experience is dignified, where you don't feel othered because you're not in a car, driving a car, or using that mode of transportation. Mm-hmm. And I think part of that vision includes an intersectionality of different issues, which has been discussed here. So not just transportation, but really looking at planning and design and having a true understanding for ensuring that there are deeper connections to the natural world, whether that be through tree canopies and like open plazas where we can gather, because I do think the intentionality around the disconnect from design is intentional, right? I mean, it keeps us apart as opposed to gathering for a variety of different reasons. So,
I would like to, I'm sorry, I don't know if we're raising our hands in the participants or if I'm jumping in, but I have such a different perspective, and I was listening, but my school was built in 1927. And so when we talk about schools being built and then built around crosswalks and crossing guards, most of LA Unified schools are very old. And, you know, we have so many structural problems that we are really tackling. We have to prioritize, and safety is a priority. However, when you get in the building, we have another set of safety issues. So there's so many things to talk about. And I've been around for a long time here at Cienega. I've been to numerous at Faye Dodo's, where the city will come out and they will do some sort of survey. And that was 5 years ago. We were talking about making a biking zone or a biking lane. Now that we have these buildings that are being built like apartment buildings because of the regentrification, now you can't even park where you used to park. So let alone, you're not getting a biking lane right there. So it's again, I know we're talking about reform and what do we look for the future. We have to look at where our future is going, and then how do we come back and circumvent that to have these conversations with people who can make the decisions, because these developers are far ahead of us. And so where there should have been a biking lane down Adams, now you can't even park. So don't even think that that's going to become a parking, you know, a biking zone. I hope I'm making sense, but I think we need to know what the future is going to look like within the next 3 years, so that then we can see where exactly we can have a biking zone or even a pedestrian free zone. I don't know if I'm making sense with that. But the other thing that concerns me is, I'm sorry, that thought just went out of my head. But okay, the next person go, and I'll come back with that. But I was just getting going with everything that people are saying. But our buildings are so old that, no, we're not building new schools. I can tell you that. Charter schools, maybe private schools, but public schools, we're using the existing schools that we have because we don't have that kind of funding. We're trying to just repair what we already have. Hence the reason for Prop 39 and co-locations is because we're out of space.
Well, thank you for saying that.
I think Auda had her hand raised and may want to respond. And this is great because this is exactly the type of conversation we're going to be having in the third segment. So Auda, I'll let you respond, and then I want everyone to kind of hold it because we're going to have a little bit of a bio break for everyone, stretch break, and then we're going to go into the third segment where we can really start to collaborate. But go ahead, Auda.
I just want, in my big picture dream, I guess, or my hopes for more mobility justice is for people to also have a change of minds and hearts. A lot of the issues that we have around building more bike lanes and more pedestrian pathways come from people's fears. Small businesses thinking that this is gonna destroy their business. People thinking that is unsafe when you see people driving or biking around, especially if you're a person of color. So I think I echo what everyone else said, but what would I really like to see is also some real education and transformation in Los Angeles, so that people not only see biking as a source of a resource for them, but also public transit and another like mobility ways for us.
Thank you all. Thank you all so much for your energy and your passion and your work. No worries, Kimberly. You're jumping ahead, but I love it. And that'll help us really frame the third segment. So before we get to that, we're going to take a short 5-minute break. So please feel free to get up, stretch, drink some water, use the restroom, and let's meet back here at 11:32. Thank you.
Okay, hello?
I'm here.
Okay, is everybody back with us?
Hi, Yolanda.
Hey, Brooke.
I'm back.
Okay, she didn't. Okay, we're just trying to get everyone on and I'm waiting for the co-creator. Anisha, are you with us so I can start?
Go ahead, I'm here.
Okay, all right, thank you everyone. And we're back for our third segment, which we have titled Cooperative Dialogue and Aligning. Just to make a note that basically the goal, again, you know, of this event was to build community resilience and align meaningful support in this time of the COVID-19 pandemic and the rising threats of racism on Black lives. And as we talked about in both of our segments, one and two, along with celebrating the successes that grassroots advocacy can bring to our members, emphasizing pedestrian safety for Black, Indigenous, people of color and their lives. And the fact that it's gonna take all of us to work together in terms of creating, moving forward, a more sustainable living environments, more equitable environments, and anti-racism environments. So Kimberly got us started off, jump-started us as we move into our third segment, which is transitioning into the days to come. And basically, we are going to open the platform for this conversation of much that has been shared and said, both in terms of the needs, our challenges, the threat on Black lives, pedestrian safety in our communities of color, understanding that we are in a time of co-creating. And so that's what this is all about. It's gonna take all of us. It's not one set organization. It's really what the message is of this webinar. So we have to figure out how we can come together and support each other in ways that have not been done, in ways where we talk about the systemic issues that exist in our community and in our nation, that I actually grew up for the majority of my young years trusting in the American dream, only to find out that that dream was not something that I really should have trusted in. I was trusting in my family, in my village. That's who held me up, not the American dream. And so basically that's what we're talking about here, is the fact that we have to reframe, you know, how we uplift ourselves in this time is one of the most crucial times in terms of this new normal and this transitioning. We play a role in what America is going to look like. We, each of us, play a role in what our community, what safe pedestrian mobility justice looks like. And if we don't, then it's gonna continue to be the way that it is. So opening up that platform, I hope on both sides, the schools, as well as the community advocates and leaders have written down their questions. And I'm just gonna open up the platform. Maybe Kimberly, you can start since you kind of stopped at a certain point, but with one question that you can put out to our community advocates that we have here, and then let them start, and then that's how the dialogue will play out. We consider this really moving into a sacred space. And this is something basically kind of built on the model of what I actually learned a lot about in graduate school at Antioch. It's called the Just Transition Process. And this would be going into, we're moving into our thinking and the way that our advocacy efforts of a regenerative effort, a regenerative economy. And what we're doing at this moment is moving into a sacred space in terms of how we can cooperatively work together to build a better tomorrow. So Kimberly, if you wanna start.
Thank you. So, sorry if I jumped again a little bit. However, it did help, this form has really helped me to frame my question. Because at the school site, we do have, you know, pedestrian safety assemblies, bicycle safety assemblies. How as a community, because I'm at the elementary level, so my kids are pretty much compliant for the most part. If you tell them to do something, they will do it. How do we continue that so that they can maintain that thinking and that training as they matriculate through middle school, high school, and they are citizens within our communities. And I know I haven't said, but my population is 85% Latino, 14% African-American, and 1 to 2% white, and is gradually changing with more of our white students because of the regentrification and so forth. But the students that either, you know, scoot to school on a scooter or ride a bike, we lock those you know, modes of transportation up for them so that nobody will play with them, steal them, etc. So how do we change that mentality, and how do we continue when they leave Cienega to continue that process within this changing community? Because when they get to middle school, they don't have the same mentality they had in elementary school, high school, and so forth, because they're doing what you want them to do. It's until they become an adult that they don't.
Yeah, I think, I'll just be real brief. I think it's really important to make them, at this point, even though they are following all the safety rules, to make them critical thinkers, to make them see the whole neighborhood, the whole system, and what we were talking about before, so that when they're a little older, they know how to address the challenges when things are not as safe, because they'll be going to a different school and you don't even know what school they'll be going to.
Right.
So I think it's important to let them know how large the challenges will be when they get to middle school, when they get to high school, when they get to college. And I think Channing's going to talk more about this, and so are our other organizers. Create young organizers, create young systems thinkers, create young problem solvers, so that they're not just being compliant, but they're actually creating a new rule and creating a new vision and creating a new neighborhood, right? That's what I think. And I think especially in the time of COVID and the time of civil unrest, we need to inspire our children to be dreamers, to envision a different future, so that they not just have a daily purpose of going to school and maybe going to college someday, but actually have their own vision of how they want to transform their neighborhoods. I think that's a good place to start, and I'll stop because I know I have some really excellent speakers on that issue, on that topic.
So I saw my name invoked, so I guess I'll go next.
Thank you, Chana.
I'm going to come back to the comment. I want to read the comment in the chat, but nonetheless. So I think the process of which you're talking about, Kimberly, is the reason why they change is because oftentimes they're getting the false narrative in elementary. And then in middle school, then they learn, oh, the world isn't that great. Actually, there is a country that's going against me. And then that, I mean, either which way, whether they learn that or not, you know, teenagers are going to be rebellious because that's what they do. They love to be rebellious. But learning that whole history of like, oh, actually my people have been enslaved and they're still being locked up and all the things that are going on with the race of people, then stems them to be even more rebellious. And so safety isn't, you know, safety in the way that many elementaries are teaching it isn't going to be something that they hold on to, because then you're talking about follow the laws, cross the street, use the crosswalks. But, you know, in the same token, they're seeing on the news that Black people are being stopped by the police. And, you know, I mean, even Cornel West was stopped at his house for going into his own house. How the hell do you get to a Black intellectual and tell him he doesn't belong in his own house? And so in our experience, it is really starting from a foundation of truth and a foundation of showing them the full picture, right? And so the other thing I didn't talk about is that we actually have this strategy in Soul Center, and it's related because we have this bookstore next door. And right now we have a lot of books for a lot of older adults and high school students, but we are already looking at what are the books that are good for children to even start learning about this system, right? So there's a great book, I can't remember the name of it, but it talks about Paul Robeson and how they actually, you know, basically brutalized Paul Robeson for his beliefs. And it's a kid's book and it's actually really beautiful. and so that is, I can definitely go take a picture on the break and send that to everyone. But, you know, we're trying to figure out how do you organize the kids. And I don't think it's aspirational. I mean, when you think about every other institution, they're organizing kids, right? Think about the church. There's Sunday school. They're teaching kids the Bible right from children, from childhood, right? Think about even some of the things that LAUSD makes you do, like the Pledge of Allegiance, right? They're teaching you right from elementary school that this is one nation under God, indivisible. But leaves out the indigenous people, leaves out the Black people, leaves out the Latinx people, right? So, you know, the system is very good at organizing our youth, and we need to, you know, figure out how do we organize our youth. And so we organize with high school students, so we've organized with middle school students with the high school, middle school right here, Audubon. There was one point we even had a junior summer leadership academy. Which I know it sounds crazy, but we were organizing elementary school students at 5 years old. And so we're no longer doing that, but we definitely aspire to make that work continue to happen. And so, that's how you do it. Work with organizations that are really training our youth and figure out how they can be involved in the school community so that the school becomes really the hub for the community.
I just want to jump in here if I can and piggyback on this. Marta, thank you so much for bringing up the systems thinking approach, because I think it's really key. And on peeling the onion for students, like, it's important to be safe on your way to school, because obviously you don't want to get hit by a car on the way to school, but like really peeling back the layers of like what's happening in our community and like what are the specific reasons that are central to the neighborhood that you live in that are impacting your safety on the way to school. And I know part of the success at New LA was empowering student voice. And Kimberly, I'll tell you, the sixth graders blew me away. So they're not elementary school students. They're in that like in between middle school and elementary school. But boy, they took this so seriously and were amongst the loudest voices when we actually did culminate into a protest that happened later this year. But, you know, I can just with my educator hat on, think about all the ways that like this issue can blend into like social studies, English language arts, math, like it's so relevant. It's relevant because it's about their life and it's about their community. And I think when they attach that meaning to it, they take that with them to middle school and to high school. Yeah, in the New LA story, the kids, you know, of course, we had these groups, we had parent neighborhood council partnership. The kids are the one who, like, they were the tipping point. Their voices, I think, were the voices that were actually heard.
Thank you for that. Does anyone else have, Audit, do you have any feedback on this?
This is Marta. I just wanted to say, it's really about creating thriving communities, holistic, regenerative, thriving communities. And it's and transportation and mobility is one aspect of that. But somebody mentioned how intersectional these public health and public safety issues are to institutional racism and deconstructing that and destabilizing that so that we can create a new system of decision-making, a new system of leadership, so that the voices of youth and the voices of the change makers are first and foremost, right? And because right now the system is upside down because the lobbyists, you know, those with the PACs, those with the influence, have first access to our legislators. So we have to think about how to invert that process so that our voices, whether we have the funding or not to right. invest in campaigns. We're the ones. So that goes back to campaign finance reform. That goes back to Citizens United. That goes back to the power we have in our vote or that we don't have in our votes. So there's so much to deconstruct and reconstruct here. But I think that those are the types of things our children need to be made aware of with examples, with visuals, with documentaries, with film, with art. And I appreciate the anecdotes and the examples given here by Dr. Brooks and Kimberly, because they're the ones that are already implementing these creative and innovative ways of transforming minds so that they can become agents of their own change. So our students don't rely on adults all their life to create those analyses and to create those transformations. So I kind of just wanted to say that we're not just about, I guess what I hear everyone saying is we want to create thriving communities that keep our families and our children safe, and it's all interconnected.
Exactly.
What I was going to add here is every day, part of our curriculum, and Cienega has been a pioneer of doing this. We have what's called mainstream English language development. So if you're not an English learner, you're a standard English learner, you do mainstream English language development. What is that? It's being, it's really looking at cultural relevant responsive teaching. And here at Cienega, we've been talking about race for a while. So we are not race neutral by far. We have started work with Dr. Tyrone Howard out of UCLA. And so one of the things, even going back to COVID, with our letters as administrators, he really looked at how many times was race even talked about in the time of George Floyd. And also, why is the height of Black Lives Matter? Not one time was race mentioned. In 92% of the administrator letters. So I agree with Dr. Brooke when she was talking about not being race neutral, but even in to frame everything that we're talking about, we need to be culturally responsive. And what does that mean? We need to look at all of our biases and we need to totally interrupt that or disrupt that in order for us to move forward. Because whether we're talking about bike lanes, buses, school, traffic safety, redlining, we all need to have a forum like this and really look at what our own biases are. Mm-hmm. And then we need to disrupt that in order to promote safety, not only for students, but for our working parents that drop those students off or allow them to even ride their bikes or walk to school. So we need to really look at what are our biases? Why are we having this regentrification? And because it's here, we need to have a conversation about how we're going to live together in this community. Because what we've been fighting for years, these developers only got within a matter of months because mm-hmm. it's money yes. that really has driven everything that's happening in these communities. Mm-hmm. So for me, we're all on the same page here, whether we agree or not with defunding the police, or we all agree about police reform. But again, what is the true root here? And it's all we're talking about race and people of color, but we need to come up with a way. And I think this is what we're talking about is how do we move forward with everybody's needs? Because we mm-hmm. all, in a school community, we have a lot of needs. It's mm-hmm. it's just not the traffic safety, but safety for us, we can be defined right. in so many ways. It could be defined as, what are the nails or the bolts that are holding up the school from 1927. So, wow. I mean, there's so many needs that we have here and we're all on the same page. But again, I think we need to start talking about being culturally responsive, which I appreciate what Dr. Brooks has said, or Dr. Rios has said, but again, I think we need to be culturally responsive mm-hmm. before we can even be culturally relevant.
Yeah, and this is going to sound a little challenging, but sometimes I think we elect individuals based on, you know, whether for a long time, right? After the civil rights movement, we elect individuals because they look like us, whether they're Latino or African-American, and that sometimes we don't do a further analysis. So what's behind that? What's right. their history? Who are they getting funded by? You know, what are their actual goals? Not just what they say to the people, not just their rhetoric, but what are their actual goals? And what is their voting record like if they already have a voting record? So it's about creating that level of awareness too, because if we get somebody who's very pro-development, whether he looks or she looks like me or not, that's not in line with the goals and the vision that I have for my community, for my neighborhood. So I guess I just wanted to put that out there too, because sometimes we spin our wheels too long as organizers, and we could cut that organizing strategy shorter if we had the right representation, right? So,
I know our field rep is Kamani Black from Herb Weston's office.
Yes.
And he's very responsive for anything that I needed. And maybe bringing him in to this conversation and really and letting him know what our needs are. I know he's helped me with sinkholes in front of the school, getting trees cut in front of the school. And so he's been extremely responsive mm-hmm. to our needs.
Yep, that's a great idea. Especially right now, since it's election season.
Right.
Right.
Kimberly, when school is back in session, I'm sure you're like I used to be. I was out at Carline in the morning, helping to direct the flow of traffic. Invite him to come out and help you out at Carline duty in the morning. I know that was a big eye opener. I didn't do that with CD10, but I did that with Laura Davis at Mid-City Neighborhood Council, and she was blown away when she saw mm-hmm. what was going on there. So if you have a good relationship, bring him on out.
Yes. And it's been a while since he has been out for the car line. He has done that along with, you know, also the safety officers and so forth. So he knows, but yeah, I'll bring him back. Thank you, that's a great idea.
And going back to your topic, Kimberly, of developers getting what they want before schools can get what they want, I think having been a planning commissioner, what happens with developers and their buildings, they are asked to create a fund. It's called a development plan. And it's supposed to fund street services. It's supposed to fund infrastructure. It could fund bike lanes, but if the community isn't involved in that process and pushing for a bigger development plan, which is a bigger budget for city infrastructure, then that developer gets away with paying next to nothing for the infrastructure that surrounds them. And so those decisions that are being made every single time the city council meets, every time the planning commission meets, that budget for that infrastructure is embedded or should be embedded within the building development process. I don't think that that's necessarily true, you know, for the placement of new schools, whether it's in a church, whether it's in a manufacturing area. Those same requirements for infrastructure development aren't necessarily placed on those, because those are pre-existing buildings that they're renovating. So then what happens is you don't get that street infrastructure funded when you're just either rezoning or repermitting an existing facility. So it's really important. I think I'm just transitioning from this issue of involving our city council members to understand that they could be responsive to spot changes, like getting a traffic signal, addressing sinkholes. But what we want them to understand is that we want infrastructure funding for our traffic safety and our pedestrian safety and our multimodal safety. And if those dollars exist through the development dollars of those buildings, then we need to put that at the forefront and in the design of that building. And unfortunately, what it usually requires is for people to be present through the planning process and the planning commission meetings and pushing for that. And you could do that also at the neighborhood council, because those developers and the schools come to the neighborhood council for their blessing on whether or not they should or could build in their community. And so anyway, we could have a whole different class about the planning process and the funding available at the planning process and how that should be changed or how that should be different. But I just wanted to put out there that that's the purpose of that process. And if we're not engaged in that process, then we are an afterthought, right?
Thank you.
I also just want to chime in here and acknowledge like this idea that when we're advocates or community activists, like in a way that's such a point of privilege, because for people who are living the reality of, you know, almost getting killed, you know, on the way to school or their place of business, you know, and just trying to live life, right? Putting food on the table, providing for their families, et cetera. Yep. Like you don't always have the bandwidth to go to that extra city council meeting. You know what I mean? So there's such a privilege in advocacy, but there's also, I would say that, you know, the power is when we come together as organizations, right? So like the panelists here, the time that both Dr. Rios and Principal, you know, Kimberly is, you know, I'm providing your time, right? On a Saturday, right?
Yeah.
To say this is really an issue that's of grave importance, you know, to our community. And so anyways, I just want to say that. And then the other thing is when we're thinking about how we kind of ensure that our students, you know, from the elementary school level who are being so compliant, you know, and then that might shift a little bit when they're at the middle school level and the high school level. I mean, part of that is so natural, and we have to give our students and our children space to be kids and to grow and to push, you know, boundaries, right? But we also want them to be good stewards of transportation and understand consequences. But I think to, based on what's been spoken so much about kind of the over-policing or the over-enforcement of our children when they're walking or biking, I mean, I can't tell you how many times when I've seen, you know, kids pulled over on bikes or who are walking from my local middle school, which is Audubon Middle School, Channing's familiar, you know, who are lined up. And I'm like, what kid should ever experience that based on what, you know? And obviously from an outsider, I don't know what caused, you know, the police to pull them over in that moment and what they suspected. But it's just a balance of kind of giving our kids, you know, the opportunity to just be children. And often when we talk about our Black and Latino children, they are often seen older than they actually are, right? So that's a cultural and societal issue that, you know, they have to engage with, and we have to somehow prepare them for that. But at the same time, you know, giving them, so yes, allowing them to be children, but also trying to find that balance of ensuring that they're being good stewards of whatever mode of transportation that they, you know, are utilizing.
I just want us to come back to a piece that I think is important, which is empowering our communities to for them to speak up for themselves. So with a community organizing framework, we talk about power is taken. And it's good to hear folks talking about the different targets or the different actors, the different people that can give us what we want, the city council members, the mayor, the systems that are within that, you know, the neighborhood council system, you know, the planning commissions, which is so important. But let's not forget that this work is about also empowering people in our community so that they can also advocate for themselves. And also to create a space where we all are evolving and growing and learning from each other. And as we utilize those spaces where we can make policy changes and policy demands, that we are not losing sight of what's something very beautiful that happens in an organizing campaign or just in just advocating for something that we want, which is people's growth and people's development and people's leadership skills growing and evolving as well.
So as we think about this process, let's not leave that behind, because I feel like the grassroots is so important and we can really utilize that as a vehicle to not only change or bring more pedestrian and bike safety to our communities, but much more, because we know that the issue of mobility is not, it doesn't work in silos. It's very connected with public health. We've discussed this, some other panelists discussed this. It's connected to the environment. It's connected to an imperialistic, white system that needs to be confronted. And is there in that process where we can really see so much more profound changes in our communities. So I just wanted to offer that because I think it's important that this call was designed for us to talk about how to organize our communities to bring more stuff. So let's not leave the organizing behind. We need to get more people. We need to educate more people about this issue and how this issue affects them, even when they don't see that firsthand.
That's a very serious point, Auda, which brings us back to, I think we have about, 10 more minutes. And basically, Brooke, I'd like to know if you'd like to put a question out there. Thank you, Kimberly, for that we got a lot of responses on that one question. And so, Brooke, if you would like to put a question out so we can have another probably 8 minutes of dialogue.
Yeah, thanks, Yolanda. I think the thing that I'm really sitting with as a school leader is when we were going through, and it's not over yet, but when we were going through trying to get this infrastructure at our school, I had a suspicion that there were other schools out there dealing with this. I found one prominent news story about a student at a Catholic school where they had petitioned for a crosswalk and inevitably got one after a student was hit and killed on the way to school. I know Yolanda has tried to reach out to that community and we never made connection. So to be in this conversation and to be hearing about the story at Cienega is really powerful. It's really powerful. I feel like, again, it's not over yet at New LA, but if you go to our campus, right outside my office window, there's a traffic signal that's up and ready to be plugged in. And so what I'm really sitting with right now is how do we make this happen for our neighbor school down the street? How do we make this happen for Cienega? And I've got to say, I'm just going to name this. There's a lot of politics going on between charter schools and public schools right now in this city. It's really ugly. But the kids who go to Cienega are also kids who come to my school as well. They're the same kids, and they don't live far away from each other. So I don't, Kimberly, I don't mean to speak for you or your school, but I think the question I'm kind of sitting with here is there's been a success up the street, and how do we make that a success, a couple blocks over at your school as well? Can I put that out there, Kimberly? Are you okay with that?
Oh, yes, please. I mean, we're colleagues, right? This is, like you said, we have the same students. Marvin, you're right across the street, right there by Marvin, if I'm not mistaken. Yes. And so Marvin, we both kind of swap students, people that live in my area go to Marvin, people that live in her area, come to me. So yes, please speak for us.
Well, I just want to jump in here. It's a complicated issue because of the history of charters in the United States. But obviously we work at Ochi O'Donovan High School, which is a charter. the complicated nature is that charter started from a racist place in mainly the South, but also the North, right? And so, they have historically been used to take away the public education system, mainly from Black people. And so that's where the history comes from. And I think that's what people are reacting to charters today. But charters in Los Angeles, they're in a very interesting place because they're not necessarily doing that. In my opinion, they're not necessarily doing that. And we do work with the union, and they would definitely disagree with me and have a whole argument about that.
Yeah.
About what I just said.
I think it's less about that though, Channing. I think it's more about the zoning, the planning, the investment in the city infrastructure and the street services. And so if we're talking about, you know, is it institutional racism by design, permitting locations for charter schools that are deficit in thriving, healthy school zones. I think that's what we're trying to get at, and how can we support Cienega and schools like Cienega across, not just the city, but across California to have those safety elements in place sooner rather than later if there's already a school there. But if they're proposing a school, then maybe we should think about how legislatively we get that funded as we're funding the school for location. So again, it's pulling back the lens and identifying the root cause. And I guess my question to Kimberly is, do you already have a traffic plan in place, a school zone traffic plan in place that you've envisioned that will make your school safe from all the different pathways that the children come? Because I think that vision of what it would look like could be a galvanizing force for the parents and the students to say, and if they co-create, right, this traffic, the safe traffic plan or a safe school plan, passage, whatever you want to call it, if they co-create this with you, then I think that galvanizes them to be more engaged, and you'll pick a few leaders that really want to stay involved for the long haul. And not every parent has the privilege of being able to go to council meetings or neighborhood council meetings, but you'll get a couple, and they will be the voices of the others that want to see this beautiful new safe school path from every direction. And I guess that's what I would suggest. When I was doing open space in Hyde Park and South LA, what we would do is we would organize the entire community, get them to design the park, get them to design the pathways to the park, and actually get them to build the park, right? Because we had a build day, and we had obviously the contractors there, but the community, the Crips and the Bloods and the families, they were all there. And then the park became theirs because they envisioned the design and they were engaged in the process, and then they actually helped build it. And those parks that we built together are still there. There's no graffiti, there's no abandonment, you know, they're not selling drugs there because the community built it together. So I hope I didn't get off track for your question, Kimberly, but that's what I resonated with when you asked that question.
Really, it's real simple because the light is there and the crosswalks are there. All I need is a crossing guard. And because I have been here for such a long period of time, I mean, I know most of the community. Mm-hmm. And so that has made it extremely, it's made it easier. So that's all I really need is a crossing guard just to provide safety. Hey, stop, you know, come on across the street. That's all I need because the infrastructure is there. I just need a crossing guard.
Just one crossing guard?
Well, yes, okay.
Well, let's talk afterwards and let's see if I can help you get that cross guard.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I just want to say to Channing's point, in terms of the conversation between charter schools and public schools, I think Prop 39 has just made it more contentious than what it needs to be. And the whole point for us, I can say in LA Unified, it's just the co-location. That's the thing that makes it very contentious. And I don't know if you would agree with this, Brooke, but if we get into arguments, that's what the argument is about usually, is co-location. Not because you have great charter schools, and you have great public schools, and you have those that, you know, need improvement, and the same goes for charter. And we understand that our needs are the same because our kids literally are the same kids. But once you start co-location conversation, that's where the arguments start and that's where the halts are. So yeah, I don't know if you would agree with that, Brooke, but that's well, pretty much our conversation.
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head there, Kimberly. I think the implementation of Prop 39 in the district has, you know, shaken out in a way that essentially, you know, pit schools against each other, fighting over resources. There are lots of systemic problems there. I agree with you 100%. I second that.
Left out any solutions for pedestrians and mobility and traffic, right? It didn't even consider that.
Yeah.
So that's also the problem here. Prop 39 did not consider that in advance, how to create a thriving, safe community, whether you co-locate or not, right?
Right, because usually that is going to be the, I guess, the responsibility of the LAUSD principal. That's pretty much how they set it up, because whoever that employee for LA Unified is really responsible for that entire campus.
Right.
No matter what.
Yeah, and my perspective is the state didn't provide for funding for that element, that traffic safety element that needed to be perceived before any of this actually happened.
I didn't just
to interrupt, Channing, before you make this one point, we have 1 minute and then we'll wrap it up.
I will do it in 1 minute. Metro gives us 1 minute to speak as well. So the point I was going to make as well is it's important to look at initiatives that are going on in the city. And so when you're saying expand it to other schools, I think one of the projects going on in the city that's important is this Slow Streets project. It's all on my block, it's all on the next block, it's all on the next block. And we've been talking about communities like this at the Bus Riders Union for many years. How do we have no car communities and restrict the automobile? And so I don't think no cars in LA is at all aspirational. I think a lot of things that many people have thought that our work has been aspirational are coming to fruition, right? We thought it was aspirational to cut the school police. Their budget is cut by 35%, right? We thought it was aspirational for free public transportation. Phil Washington, after talking to Eric Mann, our director, is now looking at free public transportation. And so the thing I'm basically suggesting is, how do we go beyond just the traffic signal and say, no cars are allowed right here in front of the school. This is a safety and pedestrian and biking and et cetera, no car zone. And I do think that's important because it also expands to the international level that Los Angeles is one of the car capitals of the world. And literally every time you see a climate catastrophe around the world, you can literally say Los Angeles is part of that problem, right? And so how do we then continue to use this issue and other issues to expand on that? So,
thank you so much, Channing. I know I'm getting my warnings on this end. So that wraps up our collective dialogue in this sacred space. I thank each of you for actually purposefully having this conversation and digging deep, you know, to rise above whatever the situations might be in our various school platforms. And so now we are, and where that this leaves us is we've got a lot of work to do, but if with people like you, we can make this happen. It is a time of transition. It's a time of evolving, and it's a time of taking charge, as Alda says, and we the people in whatever areas that we exist are actually can play a role in co-creating our neighborhoods and even America moving forward. So with that, we're going to have Anisha step in to the next and final segment of our webinar.
Thank you, Yolanda. So we've heard so much really amazing information. We've covered a lot of ground. Appreciate the vulnerability and the honesty and the desire to really be solutions oriented. I heard that a lot today. So we wanna hear from you, from our attendees who've, you know, so patiently sat through this amazing conversation. And we want to hear what's landing for you. So we have a slide that we're going to share right now with a couple of reflection questions. And I know folks have been, the chat has been active. So I do really appreciate all who've been able to have this conversation on the chat. So let's take 2 to 3 minutes. We have 3 questions. Feel free to answer all or one, but tell us, what are your 2 to 3 key takeaways you have walking away from this conversation? What additional information would you like to learn? And what actions, if any, are you taking from today's webinar? So we'll cue the music and we'll give you time to respond. You want to share your reflections in the chat. So far, we've heard the best webinar I've sat in all school year. That's beautiful. Thank you to all the speakers. I agree. I appreciate all the panelists and organizers to make space for these thoughtful and transformative thoughts, visions, and actions. Thank you. Thank you for sharing. I appreciate meeting everyone. I've already exchanged numbers with some of the panelists so we can partner together. Love that. That's the point of this whole conversation. Marta, I think this is a question for you, but someone was asking, what is the name of the park that the community built? So if you wouldn't mind adding that to the chat. 3 takeaways. Community engagement is powerful and is where change takes place. Thank you, Channing, for dropping the call to action from the Bus Riders Union and the action on the 24th to pass free public transportation. We have to make our kids and families come first. Hyde Park, 11th Street Avenue Park. That was the park that Marta had referenced earlier. Built by community and the LA Neighborhood Land Trust and many, many others. Key takeaways, just how intersectional the challenges we face are, the reminder to never overlook the voice of our youth. Thank you, Marianne, for dropping. PMJ, along with other groups, are hosting a bike ride in honor of Dijon Kizzy, the 29-year-old Black man who was murdered by the Sheriff's Department last Monday, with link to the event in the chat. Couple more reflections. Traffic zone and busy roads near our schools directly affect the safety and social climate of our schools. We want kids to be safe. I'm thinking about how to make the community impact statement process more visible to our communities as a neighborhood council member, so we can elevate mobility justice to City Hall and work with our neighborhood councils to support our schools. The need to build broader coalitions that include charters and traditional public school leaders and parents with awareness building, leadership building. Beautiful. All right, thank you so much, y'all, for engaging in this really I think maybe groundbreaking conversation is one way we can put it. I've learned so much. Definitely, when is the next session, Yolanda? You got folks who are down to volunteer and provide support.
I love it.
So yeah, as we wrap it up, let's turn it to Channing, who created this call to action.
Sure. Actually, I was asking for everyone to have a call to action because, you know, I'm a designer and I like designing stuff and making them look beautiful because, you know, the job of a designer and artist is to make the movement look beautiful and irresistible. So we have two call to actions. And I'm sure others can share others after I finish. But one is that the Metro and Phil Washington is considering free public transportation. And so we're doing two things. Number one, we're going to be holding a rally on the 24th of September in front of the MTA board and encourage those who can come to come with social distancing and being prepared to give public comment at the MTA board. And then number two is to actually call the MTA board because they're interested, but there's not a current motion. And so oftentimes with these task force, they study something in order to say it's not possible. So we want to make sure they study it and by the end of the month demand that they actually work on it and actually introduce a motion to make free public transportation a possibility.
Thank you so much. I think we're gonna now turn to Adonia, I believe, for the wrap up.
Great, I hope people aren't hearing the playlist still playing when I'm unmuted because I'm not advanced enough at Zoom facilitation to be able to go from sharing my screen to the browser, turn off Spotify. So anyway, I hope you all can hear me. So we are sharing here the accounts you can follow on social media for some of the groups who have been featured today. Fight for the Soul of the Cities and Bus Riders Union, which Channing has represented. People for Mobility Justice, which Yolanda, Anisha, Marianne, myself in the past, and many others have been engaged with. Ride in Living Color. And Aura, I know you put some of your social media contact in the chat box earlier. If others want to share theirs, I think that would be great so folks can stay in touch. And so in terms of housekeeping at the tail end here, this webinar has been recorded. It's already available on Facebook Live, People for Mobility Justice's Facebook page. I don't know if Marianne can drop the PMJ page link in the chat box. The recording is also going to be posted along with the slides that were shared today on People for Mobility Justice's website. You can keep an eye out for that a little later on. And just as a reminder, Anisha mentioned at the beginning of the webinar that there'll be a raffle announcement over email next week for people who have been invited to participate in the survey going out to parents and neighbors of schools and kids at schools. And I think I'll just pass things over to Yolanda for any closing remarks.
Thank you so much, Adonia. Thank you to the team of People Mobility Justice, to Antioch, the Urban Sustainability Program, or Go Human, for making this opportunity possible with the funding of this platform. Also to our panelists, who also are colleagues that I work hand in hand with in one way or another, and our schools. In closing, basically, you know, it's obvious we need to keep this going. We need to keep this conversation going. We need to keep open minds, as Auda kept bringing us back to, in terms of, you know, the transitioning. Marta has brought us to the tangibles and really making a clear connection to how we connect and how we're not connecting and how we need to transition into connecting as the people that live in this community, to our legislators, to our city councils, along with everyone else that fits in that bureaucracy. Well, one thing I do know is that they should be here on this webinar with us, because I think it is an educational process that we all have to go through. And in closing, I just thank you all. Let's work in this time of basically a race war that is happening, and understand and continue to rise up and understand and participate in protecting and helping and voicing and making that platform available for Black lives, and to be open to being uncomfortable, and to be okay with uncertainty, because with uncertainty comes new opportunities, evolving into what we did today, and making to co-create those safe spaces and those uplifting, equitable liberation spaces that work for us all. So again, thank you all, and have a beautiful Saturday, and until we meet again.